morning. The Parish of St. Timothy warmly welcomes all parishioners and visitors alike as we celebrate the life of this beautiful man that so many people love, Mr. Eagan. At this time, we are not yet permitted to sing as a congregation, which is why there are no hymnals in the pews, unfortunately. And as Mr. Malloy said at communion, please leave your mask on if you come forward to receive. Extend your arms all the way up, and then walk to one of the sides to pull down your mask, consume the host, and return to your seats by the side aisles. Please rise for our opening song.
I bless the body of Owen Eagan with holy water, recalling the day of his baptism, of which St. Paul wrote, "All of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death. By baptism into his death, we were buried together with Jesus, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might have a new and better life. For if we have been united to Christ by likeness to his death, so shall we be united to Christ by likeness to his resurrection." On the day of his baptism, Owen put on Christ. When Christ comes again at the end of all time, may this Christian be clothed in glory. Jesus Christ, your Son, who who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated. We have this morning several readings from God's holy word. The first reading is from the Old Testament, and Carrie Ransford will read it for us.
A reading from the book of Daniel. At that time, there shall arise Michael, the great prince, guardian of your people. It shall be a time unsurpassed in distress since nations began until that time. At that time, your people shall escape, everyone who is found written in the book. Many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, and the wise shall shine brightly like the splendor of the firmament. And those who lead the many to justice shall take the stars forever. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The second reading is from the New Testament, and Maura Cuny will read it for us.
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to Timothy. As for me, I am already being poured out as a libation, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Anyone who receives my commandments and keeps them, and anyone who loves me will be loved by the Father, and I shall love him and show myself to him. If anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we shall come to him and make our home with him. Those who do not love me do not keep my words, and my word is not my own. It is the word of the one who sent me. I have said these things to you while I'm still with you, but the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of what I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. A peace the world cannot give. It is my gift to you. The Gospel of the Lord.
Before I share my message with you, I'd like to tell you who I am and why I'm here. I'm Father Michael DeVito, and from time to time, because we priests these days are spread very thin, I stand in here at St. Timothy for the pastor, Father LeBlanc. You can imagine that I am at a loss this morning. I don't know you and you don't know me. Well, some of you know me, actually. Michael Egan's wife and I grew up in the same neighborhood, and I used to babysit for her and her sister. I also delivered the Hartford Current to the Toohey family on Lime Street. That's a connection, not a very strong one, but it is a connection. But I am honored to be here this morning to celebrate this funeral mass for Judge Egan. And this is my promise to you, I will do my very best, and I hope that when this day will have come to an end, when you go home and put your feet up or put your head to the pillow, and you're reflecting on everything that you've done today, what we have done here in St. Timothy's Church will be the most important part. Several weeks ago, I read a wonderful article in the Sunday magazine section of the New York Times. It was entitled, How to Write an Obituary. The author of the article had been tasked by her family to write an obituary for their much-loved grandmother. Now, she had never done anything like that before. I can imagine her seated at the word processor or sitting at her dining room table with all sorts of legal pads and notes and family albums stretched out in front of her. And she admitted very early on in the article that the task was not only daunting, but it was doomed to failure because she wanted this obituary to be more than the usual boilerplate items about calling hours, memorial donations, flowers or no flowers. She wanted her grandmother's obituary to be something more. And she shared what I felt was a very powerful conclusion, and I pass it on to you. Obituaries are not about death, they are about life. When you read a well-written obituary, you know that somebody has lived. You know that person belonged to a number of circle-like relationships which intersected at various points around the diameter of those circles, that the individual made a mark, a contribution, and that life would just not be the same without that person. The author said obituaries should make us laugh. They should make us shed tears of gratitude. They should make us reminisce. They should make us nod very benignly and saying, oh yeah, the author of that obituary got it right. That's the kind of person he or she was. Now, Judge Egan's obituary was very well written. Which of you folks actually wrote the obituary? Put your hand up. No? I imagine it was a collaborative effort among a number of very grateful and talented siblings. If you read the obituary, you knew all the details of Owen Egan's life story. But no matter how well written the obituary was, and it was truly well written, one of the five or six great ones I have ever read, it didn't quite capture, at least for me, the measure of the man. That's why I was grateful to sit down with three of Judge Egan's siblings on Saturday afternoon in Michael's beautiful home on Cumberland Road and chat about their late father. It was stream of consciousness. It was very detailed. Probate Judge Egan even brought me 3 pages of word-processed recollections about his father, all of which I pored over very diligently the rest of the weekend. I really did, you know. I read it all. And when I was first assigned the task of celebrating for Judge Egan's funeral, well, the first place I went was the internet. And when you type in F. Owen Egan, at least a dozen articles come up about his work as a state and federal judge. Why don't you do that later on today if you don't think that my remarks met the mark? However, once the preliminaries were done, I felt I had to ask some important questions. From what source, I wanted to know, did Judge Egan's greatness emanate? What were the aspects of his biography, his life story, that really made him the man he was? So we started to talk about the Windsor House and Hotel. Now, the Windsor House and Hotel was a very, very popular hotel, restaurant, and bar. It's not there in Windsor Center any longer. It's faded into the mists of Greater Hartford history. But I remember going to any number of Rotary Club luncheons there when I was a very young priest. It was a good place to go for a good meal. It was safe, it was wholesome, it was welcoming. Then the children told me that younger Owen had tended bar at the Windsor House Hotel, as did his father and grandfather. The hospitality industry is about more than reservations and departures. It's about learning to handle people, to respect people, and to know people. And for better or for worse, it's usually in the bar, the pub, the tap room, where much of this takes place. The bartender is a therapist, a psychiatrist, without any degrees or licenses. He is the father confessor, without any ordination. It teaches life skills, and in Judge Egan's case, the life skills he learned tending bar at his father's establishment stood him in good stead the rest of his life. Way back in 1996, the Hartford Courant wrote about Egan upon the occasion of his retirement, and this is how they characterized him. He had the easy, comforting manner, are you ready for this, of a parish priest. Now, I take that as a compliment. I don't know about you. But where do you suppose he developed that temperament? I think it may have been the first time he was admitted to the bar. Owen Eagan was a product of Jesuit education. Here in this part of the United States, the Jesuits are renowned as educators. Think of the long list: Boston College, Holy Cross in Worcester, Fairfield, now Fairfield University in Fairfield, Fordham in New York, and of course, Judge Egan's alma mater, Georgetown. My brother went to Holy Cross. It was a second-tier Jesuit school. He'll tell you that. I hope there are no Holy Cross alumni here this morning. But when he went there in the 50s and early 60s, it was more serious, more rigid, more academic than any seminary I ever attended. And I imagine Georgetown was all the more so. I can imagine that in his classes, the Jesuits told him about the martyrs of North America: Isaac Jogues, John de Brébeuf, Jesuit missionaries. I'm sure they told him the life story of St. Robert Bellarmine, a very famous 17th century Jesuit civil and canon lawyer. And I'll bet that in his English literature classes, Owen Eagan read the poems of Gerard Manley Hopkins, who brought fresh, new, extraordinary vitality to the written and the spoken word. And then there was Pierre Teilhard de Chardin, the Jesuit anthropologist who unstintingly rewrote cultural anthropology and geology. And then what about Father Drynan? Do you remember who Father Drynan was? He was a Jesuit priest, the dean of the BC Law School, who ran for Congress in Massachusetts and became Representative Robert Drynan, bringing to bear the richness of our Catholic faith with regard to human rights and inclusion to the halls of Congress until the reigning pontiff decided that was no longer important or appropriate or necessary. This was the kind of educational tradition that formed the thinking and behavior and life of Judge Owen Eagan. Well, when you put it all together, it's no surprise at all that he won accolades and praise and deserved emulation from colleagues near and far. He made an indelible mark. Oh, and then we can't forget the most famous Jesuit of all, Jorge Bergoglio, aka Pope Francis. He came from the same spiritual and academic roots as Judge Eagan. He's just come home from a trip to Iraq. His handlers tried to convince him, even as he was getting on the plane, that it was too risky to go to Iraq, and yet he came home safe and sound as a missionary for peace. Those Jesuits knew exactly what they were doing, and I think that Owen Eagan, both as an undergraduate and as a law school student, was surely formed and blessed by what the Jesuits did. Now, friends, I've got to stop for a moment and offer a disclaimer. I am not a booster for Jesuit education. You can look up all of this on your own and come to the same or different conclusions. And I don't want to be a chauvinist about Catholics who are on the bench. Although I've got to tell you that more than a few of us are very proud of our co-religionists who serve the public interest. After all, we go to the same church, we eat the same bread come down from heaven, we believe the same things. And yet, Judge Eagan's life reminds us of something far more basic and far more foundational for all men and women of faith. You can't separate what you believe from how you live. Your faith is not a segment of your life. It's got to be the substance of your life. And I'd like to think that's what made Judge Eagan such a distinguished jurist. You can't say it was particularly Jesuit or especially Catholic, but it's something of which we can be justifiably proud. Some of the notes indicated the way Judge Eagan presided in his courtroom. Justice may not be blind, but it surely cannot be deaf or mute. Justice Eagan wanted to make sure that every defendant who came before him had a right to speak. I'm told that even the presumed guilty took off their shackles. He told them to call their parents. The courtroom was a very humane place. Why do you suppose that was? From what I see on Law and Order and Judge Judy, not every courtroom is the same kind of environment. Think about what you read in the book of Genesis, where it says, God created us in his image and likeness. I think when Judge Eagan sat on the bench, he was motivated by profoundly scriptural and religious principles, and he saw the spark of the divine in everyone who came before him for justice. Well, that's what we've come here to celebrate today, isn't it? Our English word Eucharist means many, many things. It refers to the body and blood of Christ, our spiritual sustenance. But the word Eucharist also means thanksgiving. And today we offer this great prayer of thanksgiving for a man who came into our lives and who left a real mark on them. Well, before I reach my conclusion, I'd like to share an anecdote with you. Now, those of you who are jurists or attorneys know that virtually nobody wants to serve on a jury. It's hard to come up to impanel a jury. When I was pastor of St. Justin's on Blue Hills Avenue, I was asked to serve on a jury. And I'm ashamed to say I did my best to get out of it. I was not only pastor of the parish, I was Catholic chaplain at Mount Sinai Hospital, I was a solo pastor, and serving on a jury, which may have been an open-ended experience, would create a terrible absence from the people who needed me most. They would have none of it. I went down to Washington Street, sat there all day, was rejected by a couple of judges, told to go back and wait, and I was finally impaneled on a jury. I reported the next day, and I've got to tell you, I don't know why the jury commissioner hasn't called me again. It was an absolutely meaningful experience. It was almost like going to church. Ritual is my stock in trade as a priest, you can imagine. And the ritual of the courtroom, well, it was absolutely engrossing. When the jury came in, everybody stood. Do you run your courtrooms that way? Maybe, maybe not. When the judge came in, everybody stood. And there the judge sat presiding over the whole thing as the arbiter, the guarantor, and the decider of justice. What an exalted position in the community. And as I say, it's well known that Judge Eagan didn't want the defendants to wear shackles. He respected even the most degenerate person in front of him. Why was that? Because everybody had the spark of the divine in them, even though it may have been on the verge of going out or been dim to the point of not noticing it. Well, these are all the things that are in the air today. We're sorry that he's gone. We're glad that he lived. And I think that when he reached the metaphorical gates of heaven, now notice I say metaphorical. I don't think there are gates in heaven. Heaven's not a gated community. How else would the guardian angels get out to keep us safe and happy? The good shepherd doesn't want a long line. He doesn't want a long wait. He wants to get everybody in, even the lost sheep. But I ask you a question, and I've saved the question for the very end of my sermon this morning, and I want you to think about it. I really do. What do you suppose Judge F. Owen Eagan heard from his Lord and Master when he stood here and the Good Shepherd stood here at the threshold of heaven? In that nanosecond when he transitioned from life on earth into eternal life, what do you suppose Judge Eagan heard? I suggest Judge Eagan heard the following: "Well done. Welcome home, Your Honor." Now, would all of you please stand? Before we continue with our celebration of the Holy Eucharist, we remember in prayer, not our needs only, we pray for the needs of the church, the world, and the community too. Owen Eagan will now lead us in these petitions and intercessions.
Brothers and sisters, with hope in the resurrection of Christ and with deep sorrow in the loss of one we loved, let us call on God, source of all kindness and comfort, to listen to our needs and hear our prayer. Please respond, Lord, hear our prayer. God of all creation, in baptism, Owen was given the pledge of eternal life. May he now be admitted to the company of the saints. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Generous God, expand our hearts in gratefulness for the gift of Owen, a loving, faithful, and faith-filled man who loved life as a devoted husband, father, grandfather, great-grandfather, brother, friend, lawyer, and judge, a peacemaker, a man of integrity and respect for all, a Renaissance man who balanced his passion for family, work, and God. May Owen's legacy inspire us to live our lives in kindness and goodness. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God of our ancestors, may Owen be welcomed into his heavenly home by all those he loved who have gone before him, especially his beloved wife Joan, his parents, Francis and Maisie, his sister-in-law Elizabeth, brother-in-law Jack, and nephew Russ. For all his loved ones, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God of all those who sorrow, the family and friends of Owen seek comfort and consolation. Bring light and love to the darkness and doubt that comes with grief. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Faithful God, today we ask your choicest blessings on Owen's family, children, Marianne, Michael and his wife Gerlin, Owen and his wife Judy, Margie and her husband Richard, on grandchildren, Mike, Elizabeth, Carrie, Derek, Kevin, Kaylee, Charlie, Maura, Nick, Owen, Aiden, and Sage, and great-grandchildren, Tyler, Connor, Shay, William, Tate, on his sisters, Mary and Margie, his brother-in-law, Sam, and special longtime friend, Sally, on all extended family members of the Eagan family. For all these, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Provident God, bless all veterans and active service members who have served our country with courage and sacrifice. Send your special grace of thankfulness to fill their hearts and lives with peace. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us take a moment now to remember our personal needs and intentions. For all these, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God of mercy, hear the prayers we voice this day. Increase our minds and hearts, the risen life we share with Christ, and help us to grow as your people toward the fullness of eternal life with you. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Okay, would all of you please be seated?
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation too, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Holy Father, Almighty and ever-present God. In Christ, who rose from the dead, our hope of resurrection dawns. The sadness of death gives way to the bright promise of immortality. For those who have been faithful, life is changed, not ended. When the body of our earthly dwelling lies in death, we gain an everlasting dwelling place in heaven. Now, with all the choirs of angels in heaven, we proclaim that glory as we sing.
Heaven and earth are full.
Father, you are holy indeed. You are the fountain of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and willingly gave himself up to death for us, Jesus took bread. Giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his friends, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, Jesus took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his friends, saying, "Take this, all of you, drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Together and in song, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again.
And so we celebrate this memorial Christ's own death and resurrection. We offer you, Father, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation. We give you thanks that you have counted us worthy to be in your presence and serve you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, our church, here and throughout the world. Bring us to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Leonard, our Bishop, and his assistant bishop, and all the clergy. Remember your servant, Owen Eagan, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who is united with your Son in baptism may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have gone to their rest in the hope of rising again, and all who have died in your friendship. Welcome them, Lord, into the light of your presence. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with Mary, the Virgin Mother of God, her spouse, Saint Joseph, with the apostles and saints who have done your will throughout the ages, we too may inherit eternal life, and may praise you and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Taught us to call God our Father. He wants us to say, "Our Father." Every evil, grant us peace in our day, and by the help of your love for us, May we be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we joyfully prepare for the coming again of our Savior Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, I leave you peace, that peace which the world cannot give. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of our church, and grant us all the peace and unity of your kingdom, where you live forever and ever.
Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Let us offer each other a sign of that peace.
This is Jesus Christ. He is the living bread, down from heaven for us to eat and never die. How blessed we are to receive him. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
I'm delighted that we're going to have some words of remembrance. Michael Eagan will now come forward and speak on behalf of his family.
Good morning, and thank you, everyone, for being here to celebrate my father's beautiful life. And I know he's here because just in the back of my head, I hear, Michael, don't say anything inappropriate. I'll do my best. No promises now, Dad. So, basically, I want to say my father was an extremely accomplished man. He had a strong work ethic, great mediation skills. Everybody knew him. Everybody that's here knew him, was aware of his work talents. I don't want to focus on the law aspect of his life. The way I want people to understand and remember my father is a wonderful, hardworking, patient, family man, kind person. He was very well balanced. He was humble. He was a great husband. He adored my mother. He was a great father, father-in-law, brother, brother-in-law, uncle, cousin, grandfather, and great-grandfather. Dad put his faith, his wife, his family, his relatives and friends first in everything he did. He was such an unselfish man. Dad had a strong Christian faith. He lived it daily. He wanted to be sure all our needs were taken care of. Then he would take care of himself if he had time. And as our families grew, he and Mom were always up for getting together at events, for meals, and for church. And his growing family just was very important to him, and he wanted to be very much a part of their lives. He had a great sense of humor. He had a great laugh. He loved to laugh. I don't know if anybody, when you can get him going, he would have a great belly laugh. But Dad was always a perfect gentleman. He never went through a door without holding it or past someone that was struggling without asking if he could help. And in his 2.5 years, in these past 2.5 years, when Dad was not well, any small or big thing that was done for him was preceded with a please and followed by a thank you and a warm smile. He never complained. That's the way he was until he died. You asked him how he was over the past 2 years, and he would say, I'm fine, or I'm good. Sometimes he'd say, okay. He was very appreciative of others and all the help they were giving him. Dad had beautiful blue eyes. He had a warm smile that would immediately put you at ease. He was always glad to see you, unless there was a Red Sox game on TV. And he'd want you to go away for a while. But he had a great speaking voice that was always calm and strong. He was very intelligent and well-read. He was quiet. He was a mentally and physically strong man. He had tremendous discipline. He was just a kind, honest, humble, and extremely loyal. He loved his country, and he always worked hard to make it better. And Dad taught his children to be strong and good of character. And he always told me I got that backwards. He goes, I didn't want characters, I wanted strong characters. But Dad was always positive with people. He always looked for the best in people and the situation. He was very slow to anger, and you had to be careful if he did, but very seldom could you push him over the edge. He was a wonderful listener. He always said to us, there are two sides to every story. Be sure you listen to both. And he was a great teacher. He would take us on family trips and be sure we learned the history of the area as we were having fun. He would use everyday opportunities to teach us to do the right thing. And this tradition continued with his grandchildren and his great-grandchildren. He was, every moment of his day was almost like a teaching moment. I could go on. These are just a few of the characteristics that made our dad so special. We were so blessed to have him as our dad. I just wanted to share this with you so you can remember him the same way. And as we leave here today, we should be happy for Dad. He is no longer suffering. We know that Dad is in heaven with God, and my mom, and the rest of his family, relatives, and good friends. We know that that is his reward for a life well lived on earth. Please remember his accomplishments, but please never forget how he lived. This is a wonderful group of people here to honor my dad, and thank you. As we all leave church today, please try and incorporate some of my father's caring way for people and the way he treated people into our own lives. Let's please put actions to work in this crazy world right now. Share a warm smile, say a kind word, take a little extra time to listen to somebody, hold the door open. Talk and listen to your children. And work hard. Gotta work hard. That is a wonderful way to be sure Dad's legacy lives on. Thank you very much for taking the time to be here. We love you all. We love your dad. We miss you. Rest in peace.
Let us pray. Father, your Son, Jesus Christ, gave us this wonderful sacrament of his body and blood to guide us on our pilgrim way home to heaven. May our brother Owen, who came to this table from the very beginning days of this parish, come now to that banquet of eternal life which Christ has prepared for us in heaven. We ask you this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
My friends, before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother. May this, our farewell, express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen us in hope. For one day we shall joyfully greet him again, for the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself.
Thank you.
in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he too will rise with Christ on the last day. We give you thanks for the many blessings which you bestowed upon him during his lifetime on earth. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to this prayer. Open the gates of paradise to your servant, and help us who remain comfort one another with the assurances of our faith, till we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother forever. All this we ask through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
In peace, let us now take home to his place of rest. Thank you.